Now, the topic that we are starting with today, okay, is cost of capital. First, we would go and look at the sources of capital. So, imagine there's an individual who's willing to start a new business or planning to start a new business. So, capital means the amount of money he would need to start with the business. So, now tell me, what are the sources through which he can generate this capital? Equity. So what does equity mean? Your own money? Shareholders' money. So as of now, let us say this is A and B who are best friends. These two are going to be the owners of the company. Will they also be the shareholders? Yes. So amount of money that A plus B puts in together, we will call this as equity capital. Okay. Have you ever thought why? So capital is understandable, the amount of money that we put in the business. Have you ever thought why the word equity? So we will say that one share will have an equal right vis-a-vis the other shares. So therefore we would call them as the equity shares. So equity capital is one possible source, which is simply investing your own money. What else? Debt. So you go to a bank, you take a loan. And of course, that will help you grow your business. What else? Shareholders' money. Debentures. We'll put that into debt. Relatives' money. We'll put that into equity. Yeah, I heard the answer somewhere. Preferred stock. So, some sort of a hybrid between equity and debt. We would call them as preferred stock. Okay, so roughly these are the, we typically also call this as mezzanine source of finance, because it is kind of hybrid between equity and debt. But what I want you to think is that equity is what owners will invest in, debt is what the bank will pitch in, and preferred stock is going to be some sort of a hybrid between these two. So these are the sources. Now look at this carefully. Don't read, I'll give you time. Now we get on to the cost part. So will this bank loan have a cost? Will we have to pay any amount on that? Yes. So the cost that we will pay on bank loan would be, in fact, let me write it this way, a fixed rate of interest. And will there be a cost on equity? I mean, is it compulsory to pay X amount of equity to shareholder? No, you're not getting my question. So as per the SEBI guidelines in India, SEBI being the regulator, or SEC guidelines in US, what is the minimum percentage of dividend that a company has to pay in India?
0%.
Zero. So there is no compulsion that you have to pay dividend, and therefore you would say that there is no cost of equity. So equities do have a cost, and this cost we typically refer to as the opportunity cost. So which means, imagine as a shareholder, I have a choice to invest into, let's say, bonds of L&T. Do you know L&T? It's an infrastructure space company in India. Or I have a choice to invest into bond equities of L&T. So if I'm investing into bonds of L&T, that is debt, then maybe in current market scenario with AAA credit rating, I would expect to earn about, let's say, 10%. But if I'm invested in equity, do you think I'm taking more risk? So you think I should earn a little bit more? So as a shareholder, I would be disappointed if I do not earn a return which is justified by the level of risk of the stock. And therefore, equities do have a cost. And surprisingly, they are the most expensive of the three capital. Okay, so we would see that much more in later on. The only difficulty is, since that cost is not legally specified, we have to estimate. And because we have to estimate, we would be learning how to build various estimation models. And preferred stock will also have a fixed cost. But that fixed rate would be in the form of dividends. So think of it this way now. There is an organization which has 50% of capital in the form of equity, 30% in the form of preferred stock, and 20% in the form of debt. Cost of equity, let us say, is 20. Here this is 15, here this is 10. So I can ask you a question. On an average, what is the cost of the entire capital of the company? Are we together on this? And then what you would say is 50% is coming at 20, 30% is coming at 15, and 20% is coming at 10. So on an average, the cost is coming out to be, is that correct? On an average, the cost is coming out to be 16.5%. So this 16.5 in this reading, which is simply a weighted average, 50% into 20 plus 30% into 15 plus 20% into 10, this would be referred to as weighted average cost of capital. And this is what we would be learning in this reading. Okay, so we would learn how to calculate this weight, this weight, this weight, how to calculate this cost, this cost, this cost, and then calculate the WACC. Okay, so for next 10 minutes, my assumption is that you people do not have background on this section. So I'm going to do some basics. Okay. Now this basics essentially will include the difference between these three sources of capital. So this is equity, this is preferred stock, and this is debt. So we are going to look at things from a shareholder or investor perspective. So when you invest into a bond, what you get to earn is a fixed rate of interest. When you invest into equity, your earning comes from two sources. Tell me which two. So when you buy stock of a company, you of course expect to earn in the form of dividends and capital appreciation. When you are into preferred stock, now I want you to think of this as some sort of a hybrid between these two, equity and debt. So in a preferred stock, you earn dividend. Okay, however, the dividend is a fixed rate dividend. That's why it's a hybrid between these two. So you would be paying a fixed rate of amount, but that amount would not be called interest, it would be called dividend. And the fact that we call this as dividend, it will have very serious tax implications that we will see later on. Second point, let's say as an organization, you're having a bad time. So you're not making maybe sufficient profit this year. So can you go to the bondholder or bank and say that since we've not made profit, we will not pay interest this year? No. So this interest is to be paid irrespective of profitability. Yeah, it is recurring. Yes. Interest is recurring. We have to pay interest. That's what you mean, right? So we'll have to pay interest as long as the loan is outstanding. And we would pay this irrespective of what is the level of profitability, which means even if you're not making profits, you don't have a choice. You will still have to pay debt. Are we okay with this? Now, equity. So dividends will be paid. Tell me. Only if company is making profits. But how about preferred stock? I mean, dividend we will have to pay irrespective of profit? No? Then we pay only when the company is making profits? Are we sure? So, dividends to be paid only if company is making profits. Are we okay? And that's why again, we are looking at some sort of a hybrid structure. You are paying at a fixed rate, but you are paying only if the company is making sufficient profit. Now, in terms of liquidation and the regular cash flow, okay, debt will always be given the first priority. What does it mean? It means you will first have to pay interest, then you'll have to pay taxes. If there's anything left after that, you would pay preference dividend and then equity. These would be given second priority and these would be given third priority. So what it means is two things. Now in case of liquidation, let us say the company has decided to shut down the business. So then it has sold all the assets and it is willing to pay now all the liabilities. So first preference would be given to these people. then second preference would be these people, and then third preference would be this. So the question is, why are they called preferred stock? Because they are given preference over equities. Are we okay here? So let's say that outstanding amount is 300,000, 400,000 and 1 million. Okay, this is the outstanding capital. Now, after liquidation, you are left with assets of only 500,000. So how will you distribute them? 300,000 to debt and 200,000 to preferred stock. Equity will get nothing. If you are left with, let us say, 1.5 million, then 300,000 here, 400,000 here, 800,000 for equity. So which means you will have to make distribution in this particular sequence. Is that okay? Any questions you would like to ask? Okay, so you can write this down quickly. If you want to invest in equities of a company, how will you do it? If you want to invest into equity of a particular stock company, how will you do it? You would go on to exchange and buy the shares. If you want to invest into bonds, how will you do it? You would go on to exchange and buy again. So the way equities are listed onto an exchange, in the same fashion even bonds are listed onto an exchange. Now, if you want to buy a preferred stock, is anyone invested in preferred stock here? So if you want to buy a preferred stock, tell me, how will you do it? Have you seen preferred stock being listed, Atul? So he said you can go to a promoter and check if he's planning to make a private placement. Then maybe you would get to buy this preferred stock. So typically you would see these instruments not listed in a lot of countries across the world. And then the question is, if that is the case, then where do we use them in practice? So we know equity is used heavily in practice. We also know debt is used heavily in practice. So now what we would look at is, this is slightly off topic, but we would spend 10 minutes in understanding how these preferred shares get used in real world scenario. Okay. So have you heard of this industry called private equity? So you had, some of you have done alternative investments, you had some exposure. Private equity is what? Aarti, private equity. A company which is not listed. So that would be called as a private company, correct? So you funds, professional funds which invest into companies which are not listed, we will call those funds as private equity funds. Are we okay? So professional organizations like Sequoia, or so many we've been hearing names, Tiger Capital, Axis Capital, Bain Capital. So all these names that you're hearing, these are professional investors who invest into companies which are not listed. And how? So typically, let's say these people will invest in your company at time zero. And the first question that they will ask you is, tell me, how are you planning to provide us an exit? Are we okay? How do we get an exit? That means, when do we get to sell our sell the investment, and how do we monetize on it? So typically the investment horizon in Indian scenario would be roughly in the range of 5 to 7 years. Okay, so recently Credit Suisse invested into a company called Hero FinCorp. Okay, so Hero FinCorp is a subsidiary of Hero MotoCorp. They are an NBFC similar to Bajaj Finance, and they've invested into it. And of course, they would be expecting that in the next 5 years, 7 years, Hero FinCorp will get listed as a shoot off from Hero MotoCorp, and then they will get an exit at a substantially better valuation. Okay, so this is how this business typically works. Now, imagine that there is a new company here, so a private company, not necessarily new, but unlisted company. They are looking for an investment at this period. You're looking at exit 5 years down the line. So you're planning to invest, let us say, about 100 million USD into that particular company. Are we together on this? Now, what you would think is that, let us assume the company goes somewhat like this. Okay, this is the valuation of the company. Now, if you invest directly into equity, then for this period of 5 years, you would not be able to earn any return. Of course, your return will come when you get an exit, and that too only when things go right. I mean, if things go as how you have planned them, then you would potentially get an exit here. I hope we are together. Now, how about creating a scenario where you get to earn return for this 5 years as well as in the 5th year when you get an exit? So instead of investing into equity, the investors will invest into preferred stocks. So when they're invested into preferred stock, will they earn dividend? Yes. What they will do is they will make this preferred stock convertible. Convertible means you will have a right to convert them into equity. So you invest into convertible preferred stock. For 5 years, you earn dividend. In the 5th year, you convert them into equity shares. You get best of both. Are you following what I'm trying to say here? So this is where the preferred stock are used most commonly. Okay, but those guys don't stop here. Now what they will think is, imagine this is a scenario when the company is making losses. Okay, this is a scenario when they're making losses, but this is where they're making profits. Now the question is, if the company has made losses, will they pay you dividend here? No. Will you get dividend here? No. So then when it starts making profit, you would want to receive dividend for the last 2 years as well as current year. You do not want that dividend to lapse. So they will make this preferred stock cumulative. So cumulative convertible preferred stock. Cumulative means, in case if the dividend is not paid in a particular year, next year company will have to pay dividend for both the years. Are we together on this? And imagine, what if your forecast goes wrong? And what if the company, right from the first year itself, just zooms up like this? It just does really, really good, and the valuation starts increasing, company starts making profit. Now, if this is the case, then for a period of 5 years, what will you earn? Dividend. But is that going to be a fixed rate? But as an investor, you might be a little unhappy, because if the company is doing so good and they're doing it based on your money, then maybe you would want a little more piece of that action. So what they will do is, they will also make this preferred stock participating. So participating would mean, if the profits increase beyond a threshold, then they will start taking 10% of those excess profits, or 15% of those excess profit. So cumulative convertible participating preferred stock, this is the most popular instrument in India to get into the private equity stocks. And of course, these instruments do not get listed, because they get converted at the time of the exit or IPO. And therefore, they get converted into equity shares eventually. Is that okay? Any questions you would like to ask here? Okay, so what you need to know for the exams, let's assume you've not understood anything. You need to know, what is a convertible preferred stock? A stock that can be converted into equity shares. Then what is cumulative? The dividend does not lapse, it just gets accumulated. You have to pay the entire dividend the year in which you make profit. Then participating means sharing excess profit once the profit goes beyond the threshold. And these are preferred stock. Okay, so please write this down. I mean, just write down this CCPPS. I might have told you earlier, if you're keen in this space, start following vccircle.com in India. They're the market leaders in this space. You'd get access to some really high quality news, and you would come across CCPS very frequently there. The question he asked, can individuals invest into this instrument? Yes. So as long as you have a lot of money to invest in, and as long as the company is willing to accept your money and issue you this instrument, why not? So even angels, have you heard of angels?
Yes.
These are the guys who would invest into your company at a very, very early stage. So many of the angels typically also invest using CCPPs. Here he asked, minimum how much amount? Doesn't matter. If you're invested into a chai thela, maybe 50,000 rupees will do the job. So depends. I mean, as long as the investor agrees and the investee agrees, there is no limit on them. Yeah, there is a threshold limit. Advanced. The question he asked, is the threshold limit set in advance? Yes. Otherwise, it will be unfair to the company because the PE firm will always want, I mean, the investor will always want that piece of action no matter what the profit is. So they set a barrier level beyond which the profits get shared.